Inkyard Press and Harper Audio present The Supernatural Society by Rex Ogle, performed by Timothy Andrés Pabon. A note before we begin. Dear reader, there are several codes mentioned throughout this tale. If you'd like to try your hand at deciphering them, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider, or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/audio/The Supernatural Society. There you can find the cipher and all of the codes. Good luck. A grave warning. To the human child reader reading this, Rex Ogle is a liar. He did not write this book. I did. Rex wishes he were half the monster that I, your humble narrator, am. Why would someone wish to be a monster? I have no idea. But now that we have that bit of unpleasant business out of the way, I beg of you, do not read this story. Go on, then. Put this book down. It will not hurt my feelings. After all, I have had an awful and terrible life, and am certain that you would not want to read something that I worked so very hard to write. My narrative here is likely to be more grisly and ghastly than my grotesque face, which is more hideous than you can imagine. You do not believe me? Then understand this. When I was born, the nurse screamed and the doctor fainted. My mother took one look at me, scrunched up her face like she had tasted a sour lemon, and cried, "Oh dear, it seems we have given birth to a terrible abomination." Soon after, my father abandoned me at the edge of a dark wood. But never mind me. We are here to discuss a different story, the one you hold in your hands at this very moment, the same one that I strongly recommend again and again that you not read. Please, I beg of you, get rid of this book. Toss it into the trash, or better yet, destroy it. Run it over with a bike, flush it down a toilet, or throw it off a tall mountain into a deep canyon. Better yet, douse it with lighter fluid and hurl it into the nearest fire with adult supervision, of course. Fire is both terrifying and dangerous. Yes, do that. Go on, I will wait. Why are you still here, holding this book? Stop reading this at once. I demand it. Please? You are still reading, aren't you? For crying out loud. Fine. If I cannot appeal to your heart, perhaps I can speak some sense into your brain. Here are three reasons to forget this book as soon as possible. Number one, because I am a monster, and everyone knows monsters are not writers, at least not good ones. Number two, because this story is a true story, and true stories are boring. It is much better to read fiction, which are not true stories. Number three, because the following chapters contain monsters, myths, magic, and mad science, which means if you are not bored, then you will be upset, alarmed, scared, and frightened. Do you want all that? What do you mean, yes, of all the foolish and ridiculous? No, this is your choice, and I support your choosing, even if I disagree with every fiber of my foul being. I guess there's no more arguing with you. So instead, I will beg, please, 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 with poison on top, do not read this tale. It will bore you to tears or intense laughter, or perhaps it will scare you to death. I see you are still reading. Fine. I am getting up off my knees. There is no use. You are incorrigible. Oh, well. I did my best. You were warned. Sincerely and worst, yours darkly, Adam Monster. Chapter 1, The Fresh Start. Will's life was over. No, he was not dead yet, but it felt like everything was ending, a feeling which threatened to suffocate him. It was the second week of October when Will Hunter was forced to pack his entire life into cardboard boxes. His video games, his comic book collection, his soccer ball, the photos of friends he might never see again, all of it was going with him. Yet each time Will taped a box closed, he cringed, like someone had put another nail in his coffin. On a sullen Sunday, he woke to find his mom had already packed the car and locked the trailer behind it. She said, "It's time to go." "I don't want to," Will whined. "I'm sorry, Will. We don't have any other choice." Dear reader, as you might imagine, these words made Will miserable. He hated not having a choice. You see, Will already felt powerless in many ways. He didn't get to choose how tall he was, more short than tall, the color of his skin, tan but easily browned by the sun, or how remarkable he was, not remarkable at all. And he hardly had a choice in his dad's departure or his mom's move. In sum, Will hated not having a choice. As his mother drove, Will stared out the window with burning eyes. His arms were crossed across his chest and had been since they left the state of New York. He did not want to leave home. He did not want to move to a new town, and he certainly did not want what his mother kept referring to as a fresh start. The car moved east along the interstate highway, the Long Island Sound just south of them. In between songs on the radio, Will's mom asked, "Are you ever going to speak to me again?" "No," Will answered curtly. The drive dipped in and out of small towns and big cities. As they passed gas stations and rest stops and too many trees to count, Will could think only one thing. This sucks. But what he really meant was, "I'll never make friends or have fun again, especially not in a boring, dumb town like wherever the heck we're going." Dear reader, what Will didn't know, that I, your humble author, do know, is that he was very, very wrong. This town to which he was headed is many things, but boring is not one of them. Before long, they entered Massachusetts, and the car turned onto a road that had a single lane. As they drove north, then west, Will looked at the map on his mom's phone. The land appeared to spiral in on itself until it drowned in the ocean, like going down a toilet drain. They passed through Provincetown, then onto a bridge that stretched over the water for miles and miles. Waves floated back and forth, rolling over and over until they disappeared onto the horizon. Will considered how far they were from a real city. They were in the middle of nowhere surrounded by water. Will realized he needed to learn how to swim. "Welcome to East Emerson." That was what the sign should have read. Instead, someone had scribbled out the first two words and replaced them. Now the sign said, "Hope you survive East Emerson." The sign was surrounded by giant dead trees whose branches hung down like skeleton arms. Goosebumps ran up Will's arms as the car crossed a bridge onto a small island containing an even smaller town. "Did you see that sign?" Will asked. His mom shrugged. "Probably teenagers having some fun. What they should have written was, 'This is a great place for a fresh start.'"
"More like the opposite," Will muttered.
As the car turned onto Main Street, Will's mom smiled and pointed. "Look, here's the town square. It has a beautiful green park, a gazebo, a statue of... Is that an explorer riding a fish?"
Will rolled his eyes.
"It's a Viking stabbing a serpent through the heart." "Look over there," Mom continued. "A library, a post office, a cafe, an antique store, even a little movie theater. How exciting."
"New York City has like a million movie theaters," Will mumbled.
East Emerson was full of faded signs and crumbling storefronts. Nothing was shiny or new like home. There wasn't a single skyscraper scraping the sky. Nothing was familiar. As far as Will was concerned, he might as well be on a different planet. "Well, look at that cute little general store," his mom said. "They have funny Halloween masks in the window." The masks at the bazaar shop were not funny. They were frightening. Some masks were vicious animal faces, others horrific human faces, and a lot were devilish devil faces. As the car drove past, the mask's eyes followed Will. More goosebumps rose, this time on the back of his neck. "Such a beautiful town," his mom commented. "So much space. Can you smell the fresh ocean air?"
"Smells stupid," Will grumbled.
"Will, I know this is hard," Mom started, but Will cut her off. "Hard? Hard?
Math tests are hard. Moving to a strange new place is worse than hard. It's the suckiest thing in the history of sucky things. Fitz barked twice from the back seat. Then he stuck his head back out the window, letting slobber drip off his tongue into the wind. In case you aren't sure, Fitz is in fact a dog.
See? Even Fitz agrees,
Will moaned, reaching back to pet his friend.
I mean, couldn't we have waited until after Halloween?
Will, you know we couldn't. Mom's voice trailed off.
Yeah, right. Marcellus has only been my best friend since first grade, and he's only throwing the biggest Fright Fest party ever, and we only coordinated our costumes to be better than everyone else's. And now, for Halloween, I'll probably be sitting at home alone, giving candy out to strangers.
This is what Will said. But what really worried Will was Marcellus finding a new best friend. He hated the idea of Marcellus forgetting about Will and the long history they shared. The very idea made Will want to scream. And he was about to. But before he could, he was distracted by a strange man on the street whose whole body and face were covered in bandages and a trench coat.
Look at that poor guy, Will said. Do you think he's sick? What if this whole town has some kind of weird disease?
It doesn't, Mom said.
Better safe than sorry, though. We should probably turn around and go back to New York.
Like, now.
Will, you haven't even given East Emerson a chance.
Yeah, well, you didn't give Dad a chance either, Will snapped.
Mrs. Hunter, or rather Ms. Hunter, or rather Ms. Vasquez, which was her maiden name, and was now her name again, frowned. She took a deep, shaky breath and wiped away a tear running down her cheek.
As soon as he saw Mom crying, Will's stomach filled with regret. In a hard whisper, she said,
Guillermo Benjamin Hunter, you may not like it, but East Emerson is our new home. A fresh start. Un nuevo comienzo. We need to make the most of it, and that means thinking positive thoughts and treating each other with kindness. ¿Comprendes?
Yes, Will answered, though he wasn't sure if he meant it.
Beloved reader, please bear with me. Our young gentleman, Will Hunter, will whine and complain and be frustrated with his mother for some time. Personally, I think he's behaving like an immature and, dare I say, hormonal teenager. As someone whose parents dropped him off at the edge of a dark wood and banished forever after, I find it more than decent of Miss Vasquez to keep and even love her son in spite of his dramatic behavior. But never mind my opinions. I'm here to tell you Will's story.
I bet this town doesn't even have a comic book store, Will thought to himself. Now where am I going to get the latest Monster World comic?
He craned his neck out the window. The air felt salty and wet. They passed a strip mall with all of its stores closed or boarded up. That's when Will noticed a rickety robot clanking down the street. It stopped to speak to a woman who seemed to be dead, or in this case, undead. She had on a floral dress and a straw hat with a band of flowers. She was also covered in dirt as though she'd just crawled out of her own grave. As she waved to the robot, her arm fell off at the elbow. Will rubbed his eyes, then looked again. But too late. The strangers had fallen out of sight as the car turned onto Ophidian Drive. On the next block, Will saw an old house with ghosts flying around and through its attic. The porch was full of green goblin children stabbing pumpkins with sharp knives. Next door, a haggard old man with a chainsaw dragged a bound unicorn into his garage. A terrible screech ripped through the air. Will craned his neck to look up. Two pterodactyls flew by overhead. Will didn't believe his own eyes. What the heck? Then he realized it was October. Now everything strange made sense.
People in East Emerson must take Halloween really seriously, he noted to his mom. They're already wearing costumes and doing up their houses, and they seem to spend a lot of money on decorations and stuff.
Really? I hadn't noticed, Mom said. She checked and double-checked the numbers on the street. Finally, she pulled into a driveway in front of a quaint two-story house. But look, here we are, our new home.
Ms. Vasquez stepped out of the car
and walked around to the passenger side. She opened Will's door. "Are you coming?"
Will shook his head no.
Mom rolled her eyes. "I'll stand here all night holding this door open if that's what you want."
"What I want is to go home," Will murmured.
"This is our home now," his mom whispered.
"Will, por favor."
Something in his mom's eyes crushed his willpower. He moaned but crawled out of the car.
"Come on, Fitz."
The dog, now Will's only friend in the whole state, leaped out. The St. Bernard leaned into a long stretch, then gave his massive body a good furry shake. He spotted a garden gnome in the yard, covered in weeds. He rushed over, sniffed it gently, then raised his leg until the stone statue.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.